handicapped door was locked, but I think it was stuck.
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
My name is Sue Pizer-Yoder, and I have the honor and privilege of presiding over this service of celebration for the life of Larry Jadlocki, a dear friend. On behalf of Eunice and David and Christy and Julie and Ed, I want to thank you for coming to this service of worship to give thanks to God for Larry's life and to support this amazing family. Allow me to read to you from our ancient text, words that have comforted people for thousands of years. From Psalm 124, our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. From Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. From 2 Timothy 4, which could so be said of Larry, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness from the Lord, the righteous judge will give me on that day, and not only me, but also to all who have longed for his appearance. And finally, from Romans 8, I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, our Lord. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, shall live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. So let us worship God. Please join me as we come together to the Tower of Strength in prayer. Gracious God, Larry has entered that part of the journey that is beyond the familiar and into the unknown. Grant him rest. Rest from his labor and a place at your generous banquet table. For those of us who have gathered here, refresh us with your good news. As we face the mystery of death together, speak to us once more of the hopeful pattern that is bursting forth all around us, life, death, new life. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. We trust you to be stronger than the questions and doubts within us. Help us to trust you even in those places that feel dark and foggy. Tune our spirits to the music of heaven and help us to place our hope in you. Keep us in the light and light of your presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now I would invite you to please stand if you are able and join in singing Be Not Afraid, found on page 430 in your hymnals. We have three readings this morning, and the first reading has been selected because it was read at Larry and Eunice's wedding on August 22nd, 1970. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable. It keeps no record of wrongs. It doesn't rejoice in wrongdoing, but it rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. For prophecies, they'll come to an end. For tongues, they'll cease. For knowledge, it'll come to an end. For we only know in part, and we only prophesy in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now, we only see a reflection as in a mirror. But then, what Larry's enjoying now, we will see face to face. Because now I only know in part, but then I will know fully, even as I am fully known. And now faith, hope, love, abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The second reading comes as a reflection of Larry and Eunice's journey over many years, married together, over family life, over many friendships, over many decades. And it acknowledges the work that that kind of love requires, that kind of transformational love that we are invited to as people of faith. The school of hard knocks that teaches us. Little children, I'm with you only a little longer. This is Jesus talking to his disciples right before he leaves the earth. You're going to look for me. And as I said to the Jews, I'm now saying to you, where I'm going right now, you can't come. But I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Love one another.
This mandate to love as Jesus loved, that he gave to his first disciples, he gave it to them when he's with them at the last meal, you know, he's going to enjoy with them on earth. And we call that day that we celebrate it Maundy Thursday, M-A-U-N-D-Y. And the reason we call it Maundy Thursday is from the Latin word mandatum, which means mandate. On this night, Jesus gave his disciples a new commandment, that they would love one another as he had loved them. And recognize that this command was given to them when they are around table celebrating the most important ritual feast at the beginning of Passover in the Jewish tradition, the Seder meal. The meal where Jews, then as now, recount their gratitude to God for the great acts of God who saved them from slavery of Pharaoh and brought them to a land and a life of freedom. The Seder is a meal, if you've ever been privileged to participate in one, that is full of vivid stories and special food. Not a little bit of wine, 5 glasses. A lot of joyous laughter. And it is a great celebration. Now, Jesus, throughout his ministry, gathered people around table for many different purposes. But many objected to Jesus bringing people around table. Why? Because Jesus invited everybody to his table, defying the cultural norm that said that the only people entitled to be at your table were people of your socioeconomic class, of your group of friends, of those who kind of looked like you, acted like you, talked like you, had names like you, but not Jesus. He invited people that weren't of equal footing in the society standards. He didn't just invite the important religious men of his day. No, he invited sex workers, despised tax collectors, people known for living on the wrong side of the tracks, the unreligious, the poor, women, to break bed with him at the table. Can't you almost hear the gossip? Today, within the church, We recount the new words that Jesus shared at that Seder meal a couple thousand years ago as a way to remind ourselves that Jesus wants to be in communion with us and for us to be in communion with other people and not just the people that look and act and talk like us. At this table, followers of Jesus are invited to partake of bread and wine, remembering that Jesus' love has no limits, including laying down your life if that's what it means to show that nothing can separate us from the love of God. So we remember that Jesus invited us to consider the table to be a central focal point of our faith and our life together. Jesus invites us to invite others until all can come and feast at the table. Because the table represents love. Feast on love. This is why it seems so appropriate that Larry and Eunice's family, as they entered this sacred space, placed items signifying Larry's life on this communion table. For it is the table, Jesus reminds us, where we are to gather in love, to remember, to celebrate, to enjoy God and one another. Allow me to share just this little bit of history, because I recognize that not everybody here might be a follower of Jesus. Jesus' final chapter in his earthly journey started with a sacred meal. That was that Seder meal that became the Last Supper for people who follow Christ. And it welcomed friend and foe alike. There wasn't one of his most faithful disciples at that table who didn't let Jesus down. Not one. They all abandoned him in his hour of need. And yet, he shared this table of love with them. And Jesus' story ends at the table, which leads us to listen to our third reading this morning. Jesus' earthly life is soon to end. It's in the final chapter we find Jesus at the table in the upper room, where he's sharing this Seder with his followers, and then he leaves the Seder table to pray. And after praying, he gets betrayed, and then subsequently he gets arrested, and then he gets tried, and then he gets killed, and then he gets buried, but that is not the end of the story, and that's where our text picks up. According to John, Mary Magdalene, one of Jesus's most faithful followers, went to the tomb where Jesus was laid upon his death to discover an empty tomb. She runs to tell the others. And when she returns, she is overcome with grief and loss. What have they done with Jesus? She's found crying, trying to discover what has happened to her dear friend, the one who changed her life. And our scriptures recount that angels approached her, and then a man that she thinks is the gardener speaks to her, but she discovers it's not a gardener, it's Jesus. And in characteristic Jesus form, he reveals himself first not to the religious leaders, but to a woman. She leaves and returns to tell the others, "I've seen him! I've seen him!" And that is where this text picks up. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Did you hear it? The doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus returns from death and appears to his most faithful disciples in the same room where they had celebrated the meal together. Do you hear it? The story starts and ends at the table. He
He doesn't take them to the cross. He doesn't take them to the tomb. Don't miss this important reality that I believe Larry intuitively understood. The table is a place for rejoicing, a place to build community. Beloved husband, father, grandfather, and friend, Larry Jadlocki died on the Wednesday of Holy Week. I think it was a God wink. The sacred mandate to love was given the next day. And then the other bookend comes at the other end when Jesus reappears at where?
The locked room.
The locked room and the table. Think of how many people Larry helped to feed at the food bank. How many he helped feel a part of community. Even going to a bidding war with Julie over a goat that she wanted and he didn't want to help Habitat for Humanity. To find out they're bidding against each other for this goat, whether it's going to come home or whether it's going to not come home. And it did come home. But Habitat for Humanity was the winner. He donated to so many philanthropic charities, thus affording a place to belong to many who otherwise might not. My experience of Larry was that his life could be symbolized by the table. I would wager a bet. Let me have you raise your hand. How many of you shared a meal out with Larry or at Eunice and Larry's home or were one of the recipients of one of his 250 homemade apple pies that he delivered to people who sponsored him, or one of the Hungarian cookies recipients that sponsored him on the wellness? Raise your hand if you were one of those people. Look around at how many people Larry Jadlocki met at his table. Maybe you were one of his children or grandchildren who looked forward to Stella Dora cookies. They're up here. Here, Stella Dora cookies. There's the things that he made. There's the apple pie that he made, right? Or how many of you might have shared? You know there's only one flavor of ice cream in Larry's book. What is it? Chocolate. Larry understood that something unique and wonderful happens around the table. It's the place where we're all equal. We all have to eat. So it's a level playing field. Larry was often quietly all about community building. I'm sure many of you played a round of golf with him. A game of tennis, there's a tennis racket in some place, tennis racket, or went skiing with him. He always wore this famous white hat that was inseparable for him in his later years. And then there was the intimate community he shared with beloved humans. He was the understated man behind the scenes, loving and supporting her many endeavors. But most do not know that he sent her a bouquet of flowers each month to remind her of his love. Did you know he used to play sax in a band in high school? This table seems a fitting place to remember a life well lived in community. A life that caught Jesus' desire that we welcome all to the table. For this is where we will find true joy in community. Not always easy, but with a lot of practice, dedication, and help from God, the table makes our lives rich with wonderful memories, relationships hard sought, family and friends worth fighting for. When I went online to read the beautiful obituary the family wrote, I was not surprised to read comments left by friends that reflected upon Larry as a true gentleman, a golfer who always had something positive to say to his fellow golfers, even when they blew it, a man of humility. I think much of Jesus's teaching can be learned at the table, because it was here that Jesus welcomed all. And I think Larry caught this vision of Jesus and realized that the table offers a vision of God's kingdom on earth, a place not of privilege, but a place of reciprocity, equality, abundance, generosity, and unending thanksgiving. He was a loyal, gentle,
generous, loving, faithful man. And with age, he became more appreciative, thankful, present, and loving as he grew from knowing the source of love. I was privileged to sit at table with Larry, and I was made to feel like I was a beloved friend. What could be more special or sacred than that? It was Jesus who said, "I no longer call you a servant. I call you my friend." Following this time of worship, we will gather around tables and tell stories and share memories and enjoy remembering how Larry touched our lives. We will gather around table, the place Jesus invites us to remember him in community, the place where we join our hearts and minds, the table, the place of welcome and invitation, the place where Jesus started his life and ended his life when he joined his friends in the upper room at a table that he learned in his earliest days to make from his carpenter dad. My prayer is that Larry has joined God at the great banquet table and is enjoying a big bowl of chocolate ice cream with the one who created him, loves him, and who delights in breaking bread with his beloved. I would invite you now to take a moment of prayerful reflection, giving thanks to God for Larry's life as we listen to the choir and Faith sing Bridge Over Troubled Water, which is the song that Larry felt represented his life.
Pain is all around.
As we continue to celebrate Larry's life, we want to share some stories and memories. And to do that, first will be his daughter, Julie, and then his son, David, and then friend Lori will share on behalf of Eunice.
My dad had an uncanny way of lightening the mood, usually unintentionally, when emotions ran high. When he walked me down the aisle on my wedding day, you could hear a pin drop. It was a very beautiful moment filled with emotions of love and pride, and many in attendance were holding back tears of joy. In an instant, my dad cut through that emotion and levitated the entire crowd by stepping on my veil twice. Dad was clumsy and often single-minded in focus. My husband, Ed, was on the receiving end of this more than once. Soon after we were dating, Dad asked Ed to hold the ladder while he was trying to cut a tree limb. Dad proceeded sawing away, never thinking to give Ed a heads up that it was about to fall right on him. Fortunately, Ed was able to move out of the way in time. This focus played into another personality trait, not letting events latch onto you permanently. Some may call it forgetful, but I think it is a gift. To flow through life this way allows you to be unattached to things that many others may hold on to emotionally. You don't hold grudges when many others do. There's a sense of freedom to continue moving on with life during the hard times. While I do have the benefit of being in touch with my surroundings, and I haven't dropped a tree limb on anyone lately, I have too been gifted with this trait to move on and let things go. It's a gift that allowed me to foster my relationship with my dad through the challenges and celebrations for over 50 years. My dad was all about food, as you can tell from this altar. It was a celebration for him, from the care he took preparing the meal to the gathering and sharing around the dining room table, a glowing fire in the background. If you want to see the inside of an emergency room, give my dad one of these. It's a mandolin. Sometimes Dad was unaware of the impact of his movements. When using a mandolin, this is very risky business. One evening, when he was in his pasta phase, he was making mushroom sauce for fresh homemade angel hair. He was chopping the mushrooms and chopped a nice chunk of his finger off right in the pile of the mushrooms. The drama that ensued was classic Dad. Gushing blood, ashen face as he was about to faint, Mom swiftly taking control and bringing a semblance of order back to the scene. Once we determined the ER visit was not required, he wanted to get back to finishing the meal. Being Dad and always a bit frugal on his meals, he suggested we continue to cook the sauce with the pile of mushrooms he had already chopped. After a family revolt, we ordered a pizza. My dad was not one to say I love you out loud to his kids very often, but this did not mean that we were not loved. When I was a sophomore in college, I had a weekend plan to attend a formal dance at Syracuse University. I packed my Jeep Cherokee full of dresses for the event and headed northbound in advance of a snowstorm. In Scranton, I hit weather. Surrounded by slippery roads and tractor trailers, I shifted the car into four-wheel drive, and immediately there was a grinding sound. My transfer case had gone. I exited the highway and made my way to the first gas station, a small service station with nothing more than a clothes repair shop, two pumps, and I had to find a payphone. Yes, there was no cell phones at that time. I had to call my dad on the payphone. Being a self-focused student, I was distraught how could I miss such an important event due to car trouble. My dad must have heard this in my voice because he got in his car, drove 1.5 hours in a snowstorm to drive me 2 miles down the road to the Greyhound bus station where I continued my journey north. En route to Syracuse, I started to reflect on the events of the day. My dad did not say I love you when he put me on that bus. He didn't need to. His actions spoke louder than anything he could have ever said to me. I have held that experience close to my heart for years. When I'm frustrated or sad with the interactions of the world, I think of this selfless act of my dad's love that he gave me that Friday in February, and I smile. As I grew up and transitioned to an adult relationship with my dad, I found a different way to connect with him through business. When I was young, I would occasionally go to work with my dad in New York City. He worked at the Empire State Building and would always take me to the top so I could look out over Manhattan. I loved the hustle and bustle of New York and my dad's job and how it interacted with that vibe. We had some amazing opportunities as a result of his position, including a cocktail reception where Andy Warhol and Boy George were in attendance. As a teenager, that was exhilarating. He moved into a different kind of business later in his career called inventory finance. Even to this day, I think it's one of the coolest jobs in the finance world. This is a plum tomato. Seems insignificant unless you were told that you had 24 hours to unload 10 million tons of these. When describing his new job to me, the example he gave me was a client who owned a tomato paste factory. The client wanted to take a capital loan to improve the material handling system in the factory. The inventory was plum tomatoes, 10 million tons of these little plum tomatoes. It was Dad's job to figure out the secondary markets for the plum tomatoes and how quickly the inventory could be liquidated in the event the client defaulted on their loan. This is called inventory finance. The diversity of the inventory for each client made the job that much more exciting. Plum tomatoes one day, retail clothing the next. It wasn't until this week, when we were sharing stories together, that I discovered these business discussions were unique to me. Dad and I had a special connection through business. It was a way for us to talk and express our love for each other when the words, I love you, were difficult to say for both of us. Okay, Dad, I need you now to lighten the mood. These next lines are difficult for me to say out loud. As I'm writing this yesterday, we had an earthquake. I don't need that, but maybe a crack of thunder or a dropping of a hymnal would be fine. Nothing too significant, please. I love my dad, even though I did not say it to him often. But most importantly, I know he loved me. I'm gonna leave these for you.
Julie, I really thought when I put the mandolin and the tomato in there that you were going to be slicing tomatoes in my church, since I wouldn't. Julie wanted to bring a goat today, and I put my foot down with a firm no.
I thought it would be a good idea.
I could just see it there bleeping the whole time. Oh, it's hard to know what to say on a day like today, but fortunately for me, I've never been short of words. So let me start with thank you. I want to thank everyone who came here today. A lot of people traveled a long distance, changed plans, disrupted their lives to be here and remember my dad with us, and we're grateful. It really means the world to my sister and my mom and I. I want to say thanks to the members of my church, this choir that I didn't know was going to sing today. This church that has been such a strength and a support these last week, helping with the food for the reception, sending cards, letting me know I'm loved. Y'all are a great church. I want to thank Sue. I was petrified my dad was going to say, David, I want you to do my service, because I knew I wouldn't be able to. So you were my dad's pastor at Liberty Corner Presbyterian Church for many years, and he loved that. He didn't often ask me to go to church because he knew when I was off, I didn't want to. But he and my mom were insistent that I come see you. I think the biggest presence you've brought to our family has been your friendship with my mom. The gatherings she had with you and Lori over the years have been a source of joy. And I know having you here, walking with us this past week, has been a gift. Thank you. I want to say thanks to all of my dad's grandkids, my nieces and nephews, and my two kids. You guys mean the world to Grampy. He absolutely loved each and every one of you. You made him laugh. You gave him so much to be proud of. You filled his heart with joy just because you were amazing and still are. He loved having you around. And I know he's beaming down with pride, cherishing each of you for all that you are. He'll always be in your corner. Whenever times get hard, he'll be the bridge to guide you across. Whew. I thought I'd do better. I want to say thanks to Ed, my brother-in-law, and Christy, my wife. I have absolutely no idea how you have managed to put up with my parents and my sister and I for 30 years. The stories you have to tell about being in this family, about all the crazy things that have happened over the years, all I can say is please don't ever tell those stories. You were both as much a part of my dad's life as Julie and I were. You've seen it all. The great moments we had as a family and the really hard ones. You've been there for us. So I say to Ed and Christy, thank you for everything you've been and continue to be. Julie and I are lucky. And we know it. We really, really do. So what should I say about Dad? How do I relay all that he meant to me? There's so many things that I want to say because he was a lot, but I can only share a few snippets, a little glimpse of the man I got to call Dad and some lessons that he taught me. My dad was a provider. Growing up, he commuted to New York City every single day for about 15 years. He'd take the train into Manhattan early in the morning and he wouldn't get home till pretty late. I never realized until much later in life that most families don't eat dinner at 8 o'clock at night. But we did, because that's when he got home. He did all he could do to make sure we had everything we needed and then some. And because he worked so hard, that meant that he wasn't always around for school stuff or activities, but he tried to make up for it in other ways. When I was a little kid and we lived in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, my dad had a tradition of taking us out to breakfast once a month on a Saturday. I loved it when it was my turn to go because I'd get pancakes and sausage, and I hated it when it was Julie's turn because that meant I had to stay home and clean the house with my mom. A lot of my memories of my dad revolve around food, which isn't a surprise to you by now. Hoagies from Basio's Deli, cheesesteaks from Phil's, those fancy New York steak restaurants that he'd take us to. Like my sister said, my dad had a funny relationship with food. Funny in that he was not always great about sharing it. He had this magical thinking about food, like there would be six adults planning to have lunch together and Dad would call in an order for subs and come back with just two. And then he'd take one half of it all for himself, figuring that the rest of us could split the remaining one and a half like it was some sort of fish and loaves miracle. We were laughing this week because Julie was remembering how he would make meals for us and he'd count the shrimp. You get two, and you get two, and you get two, and look, there's some extra. I'll take those. He would get fixated on things that he liked. There was a period in our life when Boston Market first opened, and Dad would bring home a rotisserie chicken every chance he would get. What do you want for dinner? How about a chicken from Boston Market, he'd say. Well, we just had that the other day. Oh, well, do you want a turkey from Boston Market then? One of the few things that he really got good at was making soup. Except it would be the same soup over and over and over. He got into a risotto phase, and we had the same risotto over and over and over. And then there was the bread phase, where he discovered how to use the bread machine, and we ate more loaves of bread than anyone in the world. My mom and my sister went to North Carolina one winter weekend for a cross-stitching convention, which whoever knew there was such a thing. And so it was my dad and I home alone, and I swear to you, the only thing we ate was bread and water. It was like a prison sentence. Dad just cooking bread over and over and over. Once he got hooked on a food, that's what you were going to have for a long while. Over the last couple years, eating became really hard for my dad. His muscles were weakening, and it was harder to get the food from the plate to his mouth, but he still loved the food. And I think he was more grateful for food recently than he'd ever been. We'd go over for dinner, and he'd say, "Yoon, this is so good." And it wasn't always. But to him, whatever my mom cooked these last few years was the best thing she had ever made. 2 weeks ago, we had a snowstorm, and there was no power at my parents' house for 42 hours. And so Christy and I went over and made cheeseburgers on the grill. I didn't know it was going to be the last cheeseburger he'd ever eat. And he absolutely loved it. He even made me believe that it was the best cheeseburger I had ever made. And he loved dessert. We didn't have a lot of dessert when I was growing up, but as soon as Julie and I moved out of the house, it seemed like there was a change in heart. And dessert was the best thing it could be. Cozy Shack rice pudding, and of course, his apple pies. And ice cream. Ice cream, ice cream, ice cream. The biggest bowls of ice cream. And anyone who was lucky enough to eat one of his apple pies or one of his trays of Hungarian cookies knew exactly how loved you were. Unless, of course, that is, you were required to pay $100 or $150 to get it, because that's how he raised money for charities. So many of my memories about my dad are about food. And what I realize now is that Dad was teaching me the importance of savoring the things that make you happy. He loved to have fun as well. That's a side of him that not enough people got to see, but he could be really, really silly. It was getting harder and harder to make him do this as the years went on, but my father could do the world's best Miss Piggy impression. Oh my goodness. The pictures that are playing in the parish hall have an image of my dad playing with those giant playing cards and wearing these huge eyeglasses as he and my sister sat in a cafe in Little Italy in New York City. He just knew how to have fun, how to be silly. As we were looking at pictures the last few days, I never realized just how much he smiled. But he had this beautiful smile with a twinkle in his eye, and he loved to laugh. He especially loved to laugh when he was on the golf course. Golf was his passion, and he loved playing golf with others. And he was pretty good at it most of the time. But I think the best memories of my dad were those moments when he wasn't so good at it. He'd line up a putt, and he'd stare at it. And then he'd walk around the green and look at it from another angle. And then he'd come back and he'd stand over top of the ball, hovering for a really, really long time. And then he'd putt it and completely miss the hole. And then the best part, he'd stand there and scream for the whole golf course to hear, "You stinker!" And then he'd look up and he'd laugh at you and laugh at himself. Those are some of the memories that I have. Going skiing with my dad in Utah. It was always more, he was more adventurous than I was. He was ready to go down a black diamond when I really thought we were more like green dot kind of skiers. One day after a long day of skiing in Utah, he decided it'd be fun to go see the Mormon Tabernacle. We took the whole tour, like the complete tour, where they try to convert you at the end of the tour. And I remember as they were zeroing in, Dad leaned over and said, "Hey, we better get out of here fast." And before I could even look up, he was gone. Just sacrificed me to the Mormons. When it was clear that Christy and I were becoming a serious couple, Dad brought her along for a ski trip as well. He didn't need to do that, but he wanted to make sure she was part of the family. And that meant being part of the fun. So Dad taught me you need to find the things in life that bring you joy and do them and smile and laugh when you do it. Make time for those things, he would say. That's what I'm still trying to learn. Julie was right when she said that he wasn't always great about saying, "I love you." He got better about that later in life. But my dad was always really great at showing his emotions when something went wrong. He wasn't really a mechanical person. He and lawnmowers never saw eye to eye. He passed that on to me. So when the lawnmower would break down and Dad was over 2 acres away in the shed, you could hear him screaming, "Shit! Shit, shit, shit!" We used to joke that we were going to put that on his tombstone. "I died. Shit." But Julie and I didn't share what we were going to say, and it's remarkable to me because one of the things that I realized he taught me in that was that it's okay to feel. It's okay to feel the frustration, and it's okay to feel the joy. But the thing about Dad is he would always move on. To this day, I'm amazed at how something terrible could happen to him. He'd deal with it and then move past it. Like Julie said, often forgetting about it altogether. He had a lot of losses these past 2 years. It seemed as if each month there was another struggle and another difficulty and another thing that he just couldn't do. And for many people, that would send them into a depression or make them angry. It bothered Dad, but he would face it, accept it, and move on. We could watch it happen. He couldn't drive anymore. Shit. Okay, move on. He needed help getting dressed. Shit, shit. All right, figure it out, move on. He had to be in a wheelchair. He couldn't stand on his own. He started passing out and falling down. Shit, shit, shit. All right, accept it, move on. He had so much strength in doing that these last few months. And that's a good lesson. It's a good way to be. Hard stuff will happen to you. Feel the frustration, accept the reality, and move on. It's hard for me to think about my dad and not think about faith. Church and faith and my dad went hand in hand. My parents met 60 years ago on Leap Day, 1964, at a church youth group event. The first time I ever sang in church was when my dad sang a duet with me when I was about 7 or 8. When I was in college, we'd sing together in the choir at United Reformed Church. As far as I can remember, my dad was on all the church boards. He gave his wisdom and his passion and his love. There was one year when my dad was the chair of the church finance team, and he had to make a presentation from the pulpit where he would talk about the state of the church finances. Julie very clearly pointed out how my dad was in inventory finance, which meant he was making loans that were usually in the tens or hundreds of millions of dollars. And he always thought or talked about money with 8 or 9 digits. So when he was preparing the church budget, he accidentally slipped a couple extra zeros onto the bottom line. You should have seen the look on the minister's face when my dad announced the church budget was $400 million. My dad didn't just do the work of church, but he loved God. He developed a relationship with God over the years, a relationship that came through study and reflection. As little kids, Julie and I would have a babysitter come over every Thursday night. We'd sit home and watch The Cosby Show. My parents would go to Bible study. Sometimes it felt like all we did on Sunday was hang out at church. Between choir practice and worship and then the study groups after and then the long conversations, nobody could hang around the church talking longer than my dad, except, of course, my mom, who never, ever left. But one of the best gifts of the last 12 years is that my dad was a part of the churches that I served. In Ringe, he sang in the choir, which meant he was seated right behind me. I would preach, and I could feel his presence behind me, like he was encouraging me. He was always happy to give me feedback, but generally, it was very kind. There was one particular Sunday when I gave a rather fiery political sermon. I try not to do that anymore, but that day I had really just let it loose. Dad stopped and shook my hand as he walked out of the church, and he leaned in and quietly said, "David, that one was just a bit much." But mostly he'd say, "You did a good job. Good sermon. I liked it." Short words, but they meant a lot. My dad didn't like to talk a whole lot about death. But this past fall, while he and I were sitting alone in his living room, we talked about it some. He mostly wanted to tell me how important it was that my sister and I be there for my mom. But he also told me that he was not at all worried about what would happen after death. He believed in God, and he knew he would be just fine. My dad loved people, and he loved God, and he knew what mattered. And so he taught me how important it is to have faith, to believe in something bigger than you, to believe in the goodness of love. And I don't think I could talk about my dad without talking about the love that he and my mom shared. They met when they were 14 years old, and they've been together ever since. 60 years of being in love. Something I learned this week, that because they met so young and because they were both logic-oriented people, when they were juniors in high school, they thought it through and decided that maybe it would be a smart thing to take a break, see what happens, to make sure this is the right thing. Their break lasted 2 weeks. 1 week. I would say that my mom and dad had a partnership more than a marriage. Like any two people who've been together for that long time, they could get on each other's nerves, but that never lasted long. They always returned to love. Dad knew that to be a partner meant you were to help your other half pursue their dreams. And so he did. He always believed in my mom's causes, and he did everything he could do to help her. He did it because nothing made him happier than seeing her happy. I think that's the only thing that my sister and I could ever do that would get my dad really angry, if we did something to make my mom unhappy. He didn't like that. He wanted her life to be the best that it could be. My mom and my dad grew up in families that were not always easy. They didn't have a lot of money or comfort, but they knew those things didn't really matter in the end. What mattered in life was being there for each other, caring for each other, laughing together, tackling the hard times together, being love, being a bridge, being partners. When I was a senior in college, I proposed to Christy and she said yes. What some folks don't realize is that secretly my sister in her heart always wanted to be exactly like me. At least that's what I've told myself over the years. So when Christy and I announced that we were going to get married in 1998, she and Ed decided they had to get married in 1998. We got married first. They got married second. We both just celebrated 25 years of marriage this past year. And we both have great kids, and we both have strong partnerships. And I know a great deal of that is because we came from families where love and partnership, commitment and kindness, support and care were the core values that we were given. Julie and I learned that from our parents, Christy and Ed from their parents. And I hope that's something that our kids are learning as well. Life can be hard. The world can throw a lot of things your way. And it helps to have a partner by your side. And to have that, well, it requires attention and patience and forgiveness and trust and respect and most of all, love. I am grateful for my parents' 60 years of love and their powerful witness of what true love is. One last impression of my dad, one last lesson he imparted. My dad was generous. This may be the trait that the greatest number of people saw in him, his willingness to help. As far back as I can remember, my dad shared his heart through helping others. Oftentimes, it was through the charities my mother ran, such as Meals on Wheels, or the Soup Kitchen, or PEI, or the Wellness Community. He was always willing to be the supporting actor in each of her great grand missions and plays. And it was hard work. He would move cots in a U-Haul for years as part of the Interfaith Hospitality Network. He would cook dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of turkeys at Thanksgiving when everybody in the world decided this was the day to donate to the soup kitchen. He'd run marathons, raising thousands of dollars for the wellness community. He'd run errands countlessly so that my mom didn't have to. He would proofread letters. We missed that this week, didn't we? He'd bring dinners to my mom when she was working late at night. He moved thousands of pounds of food for the Got Lunch program and faithfully planned the delivery routes. The list could go on and on and on of the ways that my dad gave of himself generously. It was one of his greatest qualities. He knew what it meant to give freely, to give of his heart and his wallet and his love. But in the last 2 years, Dad taught me a very valuable lesson. Generosity is not just about giving and doing for others. Generosity is about receiving as well. He was first diagnosed with Parkinson's disease about 6 years ago, but more recently it was discovered that he had multiple system atrophy, a progressive disease that tore at his body. His muscles became weaker and his circulatory system went haywire. If we never take a blood pressure ever again, it'll be okay. More recently, his heart began to weaken. And all of that meant that Dad could do less and less on his own. He needed us to help. And accepting help can be hard, but he did it with grace. He was forced to allow others to attend to his most intimate care needs, and he did it in a way that made those of us who were helping him feel comfortable and appreciated. He accepted our gift. He accepted our care. He was generous in receiving our love. I can't tell you just how deeply grateful I am to my mom's siblings. Over the last couple years, they have come up countless times to care for my dad. When my mom had knee surgery, they were there, showering and helping my dad. When my mom would get worn out and thin from all the care she had provided, they seemed to just show up at the right moment to lend a hand. They jumped in into the most intimate and difficult tasks. And the thing that I've heard from each of them this past week is that they've all spoken about what an honor and a gift it was to care for him. We were on the phone with Mary this week. Mary and Vince arrived just a couple weeks ago, just in time to witness my mom and dad getting the stomach flu. I promise you, it was not a pleasant experience. But Aunt Mary said it was one of the best visits she had. I can't quite fathom it, but I know what she means. Truth is, there was something very special about caring for my dad these last few years, and I think it was his generosity. He transformed from a generous giver to a generous spirit who invited others into his life, and he was willing to receive their care and their love. It might be the very last major life lesson he taught me. Generosity is not just what you do for others. It's how we live in connection with one another. To let someone into your life, to truly let them into your life, is an act of deep generosity, an expression of powerful love. I'm grateful that my dad gave me the gift of caring for him and being cared for by him. It was hard. It was very hard, but it was sacred. So I end in the same way that I started, with gratitude. Thank you, Dad, for being an amazing father. Thank you for being there, for teaching me the value of laughter and fun, for teaching me how important it is to savor the good things in life, for showing me how to tackle the difficult moments, to just yell, shit, accept it, and move on. Thank you for instilling within me the gift of faith. It's made me who I am. Thank you for loving Mom so well and for showing me what it means to be a good husband and a good father. Thank you for being a generous person, for teaching me how to love, for letting others love me. But most of all, thank you for being you. You weren't perfect, Dad, but you were perfect for me.
I'm super curious about this now. What's underneath here?
A little pig.
Right, some goat food. You know, I was just sitting here and realizing that I almost don't know how to do this without you on my side. Eunice, 60 years. It is impossible to condense 60 years of a relationship into a few words. There is a breadth and depth that cannot be named, but will live in my heart forever. Larry and I were partners on this journey of life. We stood with each other in our own unique ways through the difficult times and celebrations. This was exemplified in these past few years as we sought to find the joy of each day and in the simple moments. Larry was the wind behind my sails. not just encouraging me with words, but with his actions. When my dream seemed impossible, after sharing his point of view, which was much more realistic about dealing with the facts and pitfalls, he would then embrace the dream and help propel it forward. Although not always visible, he was the force, the source of energy which helped me make things happen. He was right there helping deliver Meals on Wheels to shut-ins in the middle of a snowstorm, picking up gallons of soup and cases of produce and canned food donated to the community soup kitchen. He jokingly called our Jeep the Soupmobile. He would be incredulous that I would even consider doing some things such as bringing home 40 Hubbard squash that needed to be peeled, sliced, and cooked, but he would pitch in and make it happen. He was right there with me driving to the New Hampshire Food Bank, loading and unloading hundreds of pounds of food, once again filling our car to capacity. When he walked into the Johnson House, which would become the home of the wellness community of Central New Jersey, he could not imagine how that old building could ever be a place to offer support to people affected by cancer. But he was right there helping behind the scenes and making it happen. Again, the quiet wind blowing the sails in the right direction. He brought me many a meal when I was working late and stayed with me so I wouldn't be alone. Many of the startup nonprofits I was involved in needed financial support to bring them to life. He made financial contributions and participated in fundraising events to the fullest, enjoying golf outings and training for half marathons to raise money. Some of my work took me into places that were not very safe. I know he worried when I went to homes in downtown Trenton, and he could not completely grasp the sense of security I felt that Sammy the Blade promised to cover my back when working at the soup kit. But he supported me and was there listening to my stories when I got home, never ever suggesting that I quit. Many a times his emotional support, his words of encouragement, and especially his hugs helped me move forward through some difficult times. When my brain chatter or comments from other people would diminish my confidence, he would try to lift me up and help move me forward. Again, that gentle breeze when it was needed so much. No relationship is without struggles, and ours was no different. But the love we shared was the greatest gift. I know I will feel his gentle breeze continue to help me through these next days and months. In the words of Vince.
And now Larry's niece, the Reverend Elizabeth Ross, will join all of us in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Good God, it is easy to give you thanks for Larry Jadlocki, for the fullness of his life, the bounty of which overflows into this sanctuary and around this table, for the humility that he wore as a second skin, the readiness with which he met countless projects and causes, for his easy and contagious laughter, for his steadfast commitment to the good when waters turned trouble, and for all that he relished, a story well told, a work well done, a meal well savored. Thank you for all the life that his life bore, for 60 years of partnership with Aunt Uni, rich in love and shared labor, for children and their spouses who enlarged his heart still further, and for those who made him Grampy, a role he played with downright glee. Even as the other side of the grave is yet cloaked in much mystery,
You remember and claim your promise that you have gone ahead to prepare a place. May the place you've prepared for Larry be one where the welcome is as warm as those he extended, and where the light, just like that on his beloved mountain, keeps shifting to reveal still more glory. May it be a place free of suffering, where his body is made whole and his joy is made complete. And having tended to Larry, would you draw near to these gathered and so many others who are yet bereaved? Especially, we pray for Eunice, for Julie and David, Ed and Christy, Elliot, Sydney, Luke, Olivia and Wes, Barbara and Claudia and their families. Settle your gentle spirit beside them, particularly in the lonely places. Bind up broken hearts and comfort aching ones. Touch with tenderness the tender spaces and smile upon the sweetness of memories dear and treasured. May those of us who yet bear the marks of Larry's life bear them still further and deeper into a world deserving of the delight he engendered. And enfold us all in a love that will never let us go. Living and life-giving God, we entrust Larry to you and with him the brokenness of this whole world. We pray that you would receive all of our grief and all of our pain, and then go about your work, making good to triumph over evil, joy to outlast sorrow, and life to have victory over death. We pray it in the name of the risen one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now would you join me, if you are able, and stand as we sing together, How Great Thou Art, hymn number 51 in your hymnals.
Enough for everybody, by the way, and we will enjoy the sharing of stories and memories around the table together. You know, it's very easy to do the service of a person who had a life well lived, a life filled with love and kindness and compassion. These are the things I would invite you as you leave this place to go forth and share, because we live in a world where so many do not know they are loved, right? And we so often love the people who are lovable. But here's the challenge as we leave. Seek to love the tough to love, reminding them that they too have a place at the table. And if to that end, they love win in the long run. May you be blessed to go from this place to be a blessing. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I pray it. Amen.